We're taking on Christology. At the end of this study, you should be able to justify, this is not preaching, the need to take the study of the life and the work of Christ as priority for you. Two, to convincingly show from the scriptures that Jesus Christ is perfect without any sin or fault, and therefore should be the ideal person to follow and emulate, because it's our master. I said, follow in his steps. To also prove that Christ has been existing before creation and birth, and that all the appearances of God in the Old Testament are actually the appearances of Christ. We'll see it. Like in Genesis, God visited Abraham with two angels and discussed the issue of Sodom and Gomorrah. We will prove to you from the scripture that that man that visited Abraham was Christ. You see it. You see it by yourself. No argument. To show that Jesus Christ is perfectly God and also perfectly man. Then to refute all the heretical teachings relating to the virgin birth, humanity, and the deity of Christ. These are subjects of attacks by gainsayers. These are subjects of attacks. Islam today does not believe in Christianity. These are part of the issues. And all these Christian cults, Seventh-day Adventists, they are Christian cults. One of our leadership retreats, we will take all Christian and non-Christian cults and discuss them, because they are turning people's head around. They are turning people's head around. And you might become a victim tomorrow. So, to refute all heretical teachings relating to the virgin birth, humanity, and the deity of Christ. Jesus Christ is the reason for the Bible. And the Bible is all about Jesus Christ, the Word of God. See that in John chapter 5, verse 39. John 5, 39. I want to be as smart as possible. Search the scriptures. For in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which what? Testify of me. So the entire scriptures is about Christ. You will find Christ in every book of the scriptures. Revelation, very important. Revelation chapter 19, verse 10. Revelation 19, verse 10. It's Christology, study about Christ. Revelation 19, verse 10, the scripture says, and I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, sit thou, do it not. I am thy fellow servant of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God. Read that the next phrase with me. For the testimony of Jesus Christ is the spirit prophecy. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The purpose of this study, therefore, is limited to explicating the major biblical themes contained in the scriptures regarding our Savior, his uniqueness, and his work of salvation on our behalf. All things were made through our Lord Jesus Christ and for him. Colossians 1, 15 to 18. We won't read it. He is thus the cornerstone of the entire plan of God for all of creature history. Ephesians 3:11. We'll read that one. Ephesians 3:11. I want to be as smart as I can. Now, let me use the word fast, so that you don't misconstrue my smartness. Ephesians 3:11. According to the eternal purpose which he proposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay? We need protection from both doctrinal errors and relational errors. Doctrinal, that's teaching. Relational, that has to do with the deceptive speakers and their victimized listeners. See that in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. To protect you from doctrinal teaching that is error, doctrinal apostasy, and relational, which means between I, the speaker, and you, deceptive speakers who preach to you, and you who is susceptible or gullible, that's the right word, gullible, susceptible, gullible, to their errors, is to protect you from that. Is to protect you from that. The purpose, again, Jesus is our ultimate hope when Christ, who is our hope, shall appear. Colossians 1:27. Christ is our highest love. Christ is our highest love. You cannot, the love of Christ is supreme, should be higher than the love of any woman. Like even the closest person to you, which is your wife, if she wants to lure you to disobey Christ, you have to express higher love for Christ than her. And say, woman, I love you. I marry you traditionally. I marry you legally. I marry you culturally. But this one, I go for the Lord. You should be able to do that because it's our highest love. It's our highest love. He is the sole object of our faith. There's no other name. You must come to this conclusion in your work and your ministerial life. Because you will come to face-to-face challenge with heretics who will try to dwindle you away from these convictions. That is, the Christ is the object of our faith. No other name. Jesus Christ is our life. When Christ, who is our life, secular life. You cannot take Christ away from your business. It's your life. You can't take him away when you are traveling. You say, now that I'm traveling, let me be myself. It's your life. When you're in the airport, you can't take Christ away. He's there with you in the airport. You expect your ultimate love to him. So Christ is our life. He's our entire being. Christ, through him, we have victory over the devil. Colossians 2:15, having overcome principalities. And he is the author and the finisher of our faith. Hebrews 12:2, we study to know him and pattern our life after him. How did the Jews see God? What is their perspective? How did the Jews see him? We could characterize the early Jewish monotheism as creational monotheism, eschatological monotheism, and cultic monotheism. If I want to go to start explaining this, we'll take all our time. They just mention it to you. Creational monotheism believed that God alone, absolutely, without advisors or collaborators or assistant or servant, created all things. That's what that means. Creational mono, he alone. Created, monotheism, he alone. Theism, God. eschatological, Yahweh will also demonstrate his deity to the nations, establishing his universal kingdom, making his name known universally. That's how the Jews see God. Cultic monotheism. These are various beliefs among them. Only the sole creator of all things and the sole Lord over all things should be worshipped. Since worship in the Jewish tradition was precisely recognition of his unique identity of the one God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength and mind. Hear ye, O Israel, the Lord thy God is what? One Lord. One Lord. Cultic monotheism. How do Christians? Now, look up here. The Jews is a set. There's a way the Jews see God. In mathematics, we have set theory. Is it set theory? How do you call it? I forgot it. Set theory. You have a set theory. This is a set. The Gentile, the others that God was not dealing with, because God did not send priests, he didn't send kings, he didn't send prophet to them. They are in another cycle altogether. Another set. And then the Christians, which is in the middle. The Jews can belong to the Christian. The Gentile can belong to the Christian. As God sits in heaven, he only sees three people in the world. The Christian, the Jews, and the Gentiles. See that in Corinthians. As God sits now in his end time program, he sees only three people. Sorry. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Okay, yeah. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 32. Give none offense, neither to the Jews, nor to the Gentiles, nor to the church of God. Three sets. Jews, Gentile, Gentile, Jews. Then the church of God is in the middle, bringing the Jew belong, can belong to the church if you choose to. Benihin is a Jew. Benihin is still alive. He's a Christian Jew, believe in Jesus. His brothers don't believe in Jesus. And he was just an usher in the ministry of Captain Kuman. Are you hearing me? Benihin was just an, what you call today in the church life, ordinary usher. But who took over the ministry of Captain Kuman? It was Benihin, the usher. And these are the things we're discovering, we're talking today. Say, let your garment be always white. You just, where you are put to serve, have your garment white there. Deal with God. So, giving none offense, neither to the Jews on one hand, the Gentiles on the other hand, nor to the church of Jesus Christ. So, the church is, the, what do you call, is it unism? That cut across the two sets. What do you call it? That's cycle that take part from this one and take the other part from this one and cut and be at the center. What do you call it? Huh? Intersection. The church is an, is it intersection? Unisex. Speak louder. Let me hear now. The union of the two sets. Which union say? Which is the church? You can be born again, Jew, you belong to the church. If you are not born again, you are John the Gentile, you are born again. This is where the church is. That's the position of the church. As God sees the world, he sees three people: the Jews, the Gentiles, the church. You cannot belong to the two. You must belong to just one. So, how do Christians see God? The early Christian movement, very consciously using this Jewish theological framework, created a kind of Christological monotheism. By understanding Jesus to be included in the unique identity of the one God of Israel, the first Christians developed a Christological monotheism with all three of these aspects. In Psalm 110, verse 1, they see Jesus seated on the cosmic throne of God in heaven as the one who will achieve the eschatological lordship of God, and in whom the unique sovereignty of the one God will be acknowledged by all, is included in the unique rule of God over all things. The Lord said to my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make all thy enemies thy footstool. That's the understanding. And it's thus placed unambiguously on the divine side of the absolute distinction that separates the only sovereign God, sovereign one from all creation. Now, we're going to look at the deity of Christ. The deity, the divinity of Christ, the deity of Christ. Because our Lord had to become a true human. Listen to this very attentively. Because our Lord had to become a true human being in order to die in our place, his genuine and undiminished deity has, as a consequence, sometimes been falsely and heretically denied. Our big brothers in the north, how can God have a son? This is the foundation where they missed it. And you can belong to the church. You can be the Lord's minister and still deny this and go on with ministry. Since ministry is a freelance, no regulator. Is there a regulator? God is just political ecumenism. I repeat, political ecumenism. There's nothing like unity in there. PFN, there's not any unity there. It's political ecumenism. Let's just come together and fight the cause of Christianity as a religion, not as a faith. Let's have voice to the government. That's all. So you can belong even here now and miss this. It was a matter John the Beloved had to contend with the false teacher of his time. If you deny the deity of Christ, you deny Christ. If you don't accept that Jesus is the Son of God, as simple as this statement looks like, you don't accept it, you're not a Christ, you're not a Christian. So because Jesus have to become full human to save us, that undiminished deity has, as a matter of consequence, sometimes been falsely or heretically denied. But this lack of faith on the part of some does not change the fact that Jesus is indeed God as well as man. The ultimate means of refutation for all heresies and heretics. Heresies, their beliefs, false belief. Heretic, he who has that belief, who will deny the divinity of Christ, as always the Bible. Now, we will see through the scripture where Jesus is explicitly called God in the scripture. Explicitly, where Jesus was explicitly called God. Isaiah 9, verse 6. He was referred to as Mighty God. Isaiah 9 verse 6. Isaiah 9 verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God. The Mighty God. Jesus is called God with us. He is referred to as God. Matthew 1:23. Matthew 1:23. He says, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted, God with us. Jesus is called God. John 1:1. John 1:1. You need to know this so that your faith will not be swept off. We are in the last days. A lot of serial denials are going on. Serial denials. John 1 verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Read the rest. Read the rest. And the Word in the form of God. Philippians 2 verse 5 and 6. Being in the form of God. Being in the form of God. I will come to explain that to you later. He is also called God and Savior. Titus 2:13. Titus 2:13. He is also God and Savior. God and Savior. Titus 2:13. 2:13. He says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior. Look up here. If you say the great God and the Savior, you're talking about two people. Are you following me? If you say the great God and the Savior, it's like talking about two people. But the great God and our Savior, one person. Jesus is called God. And then thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a righteous scepter. Hebrews 1 verse 8. Apart from the fact that he is God, he is also worshipped as God. Are you following? He is also worshipped as God. Luke 24:50. They worshipped him. They worshipped him. Where we read in Revelation 19 verse 10, the spirit of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. That angel who gave John revelation, John bowed down to worship him. Did he accept? He said, no, I am one of what thy brethren. Do not this. Angel, no angel has ever accepted worship. But when Jesus was worshipped, he didn't deny it. He accepted because he's God. He's God. Luke 24, verse 50. Luke 24, verse 50. God is building us. We need to know. Luke 24, verse 50. All right. Luke 24, verse 50. Luke 24, verse 50. He says, and he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifted up his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him. And they worshipped him. And they worshipped him. The blind man worshipped him. John 9:38. That man that was born blind, that Jesus healed, he also worshipped Jesus. In Philippians 2:9-11, every knee to bow to him. That's worship. Bowing down is worship. And then Jesus also is worshipped. 11:14, he's worshipped in heaven. How about Jesus? He's also a creator. He's also a creator. He was in creation. He was before creation. And he also created. All things were made by him. John 1:3. John 1:3. John 1:3. All things were made by him. John 1:3. The world was made by him. By him. By him. By him. By him. John 1:10. Everything was created by him and for him. Colossians 1:15-17. All things came through him. All things came through him. Now, look up here. This is where the real issue is. Look up here. Jesus is co-equal and co-eternal with the Father and the Spirit. We're going deeper a bit now. Other one you are saving, this one you're going to find a little bit difficult. Jesus is both co-equal and co-eternal with the Father and the Spirit. Look up. There's an organization in Nigeria, government agency called NIREC, Nigeria Religious Council. NIREC. That is a council that brings Muslim and Christian together. It's a government agency. I've been to that office. I know who their former chairman, the former vice chancellor of University of Ilorin, the present JAMB registrar, Professor Ishak Oyedele. He was the former Oloyede. Oloyede. Now, in that council, there are co-chairmen. The supreme leader of Islam, which is the Sultan of Sokoto, is a co-chairman of that council with any Khan chairman. Why? They do not want to exalt either Muslim, theoretically anyway, not in principle. Theoretically, not in principle. Not to exalt either Islam or Christianity above one another. So that they don't want to make one person chairman and the other one vice chairman. Or they run tenure of this one is a chairman, then after tenure, another one is a chairman. So they make them co-chairmen. They are equal. That's the concept. Are you getting what I'm saying? So Jesus and God and the Spirit, they are co-equal and co-eternal. God and Jesus are one. John 10:30. I and my Father are one. I and my Father are one. Look up here. You have to accept this by faith. See, let me tell you this. This is where many people stumble. They are ministers. They are preaching holiness. But when it comes to the Godhead, they don't seem to accept. Now, you cannot fully understand this at your reign until we unite with God eternally in heaven. We will understand it. But then, if you want to insist to know everything about the co-eternal, co-equal between Jesus and God and the Spirit, you have to become one of them, the three of them, to understand it fully. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You have to now become one among the three. And the attempt to know will now drive you to mysticism. Mysticism. If you say, I will search, I want to understand this Godhead. I want to understand this three in one. I want to understand this. They say, bro, take it by faith. Don't believe. I said, no, I want to know. That person will go into mysticism. He will end up being a mystic person. Because you cannot belong to the three of them. You can't break into the three of them to understand how the three of them have operated in unity from the foundation of the world. We have never had to one day God and the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit quarrel. Have you ever had that? They quarrel and disagree. Oh, God the Father says something. Then God the Son said, no, the Father didn't get it right. Because it's a one. I and my Father are. They are two. But he's saying we are one. We will get deeper. Again, I and my Father are one. Again, when you are to baptize somebody, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, we are one. Co-equal, co-eternal. Now, in our grace statement, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and abide with us forever. The grace formula. Co-eternal, co-equal. The workings of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4 to 6. We'll read that one. Cannot read all the scriptures. 4 to 6. Now, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. Are you following? Diversities of gift, the same Spirit. Differences of administration, what followed? What followed? And there are diversities of operation, but it is the same God, Lord Jesus, Spirit. Are you seeing the unison? Worketh all, which worketh all in all. There are three that bear record in heaven. There are three that bear record in heaven. 1 John 5 verse 7. There are three that bear record in heaven. For there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was who? God. There are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word. That Word there stands for Christ. And the Holy Spirit. These three are one. Now, let's look at the claims of Jesus. His claims. What he shares with the Father and the divine attributes of God the Father, which he, Christ, demonstrated. He is eternal. Micah 5, verse 2. Jesus is eternal. Where is Micah? After Daniel? Micah 5 verse 2. But thou, Bethlehem, Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been from old. From where? From where? Matthew 28, verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, all power is given unto me in heaven. He is omnipotent. Omnipotent. He is also omnipresent. Verse 20, 18, 20. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, and teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you all way, even unto the end of the world. He is omniscient. He is omnipresent. As we said, he's omniscient. John 2, 24, 25. He has power to forgive sins. Mark 2, 10. He has power to forgive sins. Mark 2, 10. But that ye may know that the Son of Man had power on earth to do what? To do what? This tea is working in your stomach. They're becoming heavy. What has happened to you is that when you take hot thing like that, breakfast, and the food gets your stomach, the circulatory system mobilizes blood from your brain. It drains your brain and takes all the blood to go to your stomach so that the food can be absorbed and taking the nutrient away quickly so that the child will go as toilet. So that physiological action that takes place makes you drowsy. That's why you are dozing off. Want to sleep. It's psychological. It's physiological. It's physiological. So I understand what's happening to you. That's why you're looking so dull. I understand. Medicine. I understand. But shake yourself. If you're happy and you know, clap your hands. You know, I'm your teacher. Praise the Lord. I say, praise the Lord. You're coming back small. Don't worry. We will soon round up. He judges. John 5, 22. He judges. John 5, 22. John 5, 22. The scripture says, for the Father judged no man, but had committed all judgment unto the Son. Had committed all judgment unto the Son. Jesus received the very same worship given to God. We said that before. He receives the very same worship given to God. In John 20, 28 to 29, when Thomas worshipped him after the resurrection, you observe that Jesus did not rebuke Thomas for calling him Lord and God. So the same worship that you give to God, Jesus received it because he is co-equal and co-eternal. Jesus is an as the object of our prayers. Stephen, in Acts 7, 59 to 60, was calling upon God. And yet, what was he saying? Lord Jesus. Acts chapter 7, verse 59 to 60. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. As they stoned him, he started calling upon God and say what? Lord Jesus. 1 Corinthians 1 to 2, 1 verse 2. Unto the church of God which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Jesus Christ, in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours. These first and early believers were only carrying out the very instruction of the Lord Jesus, who said, and whosoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. I will do it. Jesus, as the object of doxologies, oppresses. We praise him. He is the object of our praise, the sacrifice of our lives. A doxology, it's a praise given to God, which usually ends with an amen. Doxologists are intended to give praise or glory to God for who he is and or for what he has done. For example, in Galatians 1, verse 3 to 5, it says, Grace be to you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil world, according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Say amen. You see an example there, another example. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, he said, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory, both now and forever. Again, Jude 1, 25, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen. Now, I will finish this last part and we'll stop here and take our next message. Alleged scriptures, passages that look contradictory. There are scriptures that heretics or skeptics have allegedly said they are contradictory. We're going to look at them and look at the items they have singled out to attack Christianity. We're going to refute them. Praise the Lord. We're going to do what? Refute them. This is apologia. You are defending the faith. I want to start that with Christ, because Christ is the object of our faith. It's our highest love. It's our life. So the faith we want to defend, we want to begin from Christ. Now, look at it. There's a scripture that said God cannot be tempted. James 1 verse 13. Open your Bibles. James 1 verse 13. James 1, 13. Let no man say, when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. This scripture, people have stumbled on it. God cannot be tempted. But Jesus was tempted 40 days in Luke chapter 2. Look up here. We have established from the beginning that Jesus is perfect human and perfect God. It is that his humanity that was tempted for 40 days, not his divinity, not his divine nature, not his divine aspects. He cannot be tempted, neither tempted he any man. But being who took the form of a servant, a man, obeyed the Father and came down to live among us, he was tempted so that he can feel with you when you are also tempted. He is a high priest that have the feeling of our infirmities. It is his humanity, full man, that was tempted and never his divinity. We have agreed earlier that he is full human and what? Full God. So, he cannot be tempted. Jesus was tempted as a man and not as God. You will also come to know when Jesus talked about the day of his coming, knoweth no man, not even the Son. Yes. In his divinity, he knows. But in his humanity, as he was on earth, talking to you about his coming as a full human, full of frailties, as you are, he doesn't know the day the Son will come. Simple. You need to know. Otherwise, you're on this one alone. When you meet these skeptics, they will take you off balance. You will not know what to say. Again, he alone has immortality. 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 13. 1 Timothy 6, 13. Look at it. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall shew, who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only had immortality, dwelling in the light, which no man can approach unto, whom no man has seen, nor can see, to whom be honor and glory and power everlasting. Amen. Again, it's the same principle. I am he that liveth and was dead. How do you see that? I am he that liveth. He lives everlasting. And was dead. His humanity on earth. He died. Hello? Are we following? Who has argument? You know, Donald Trump was campaigning. I watched him live. Unfortunately, the thing didn't go that direction. No problem. 2024. He was saying that the other day somebody asked me, you're the most famous president in the world. I said, no, I'm not. No, I'm not. I said, who is the former president in the world? I said, no, I'm not. He said, who? It's Jesus Christ. Everybody say, yeah. He says, Jesus Christ. I'm not anywhere close to him. It's Jesus Christ. No president in the world have made that kind of pronouncement and declaration. He says, Jesus Christ. He's not the famous president in the world. It's Jesus Christ. The man want to come and say, no, you're the famous. Say, no, I'm not. I'm not. I'm not anywhere close to him. He's far there. It's Jesus Christ. I need to see help from him. No, I'm not. It's Jesus Christ. I was looking and laughing. So I am he that liveth, but was dead. You know, he was hungry too. And has seen a fig tree and thought in his heart as a man, full man. Went under the tree to look for fruit because he was hungry, wanted to eat, and did not find fruit. He said, I thought I would get fruit to eat here. No fruit? I didn't know there's no fruit here. Because the thing, the way he rushed, he lost his fruit. That's full man. But not his divine, not his divinity. He knows all things. From the end to the beginning. We saw a professor in University of Maiduguri. He would just come and write answer to, just write any answer, just say equals to so thing. And all this as space mathematics or whatever. Wrote that answer. And start solving the equation from answer to the question. The answer would generate the question. The question he does not know. He don't write an answer and generate the question from the answer. If man can do that, professor, ordinary professor, ordinary man. And when he comes to class, he say, that guy, Kumuyi, don't waste his brain. That guy just is doing something, he's preaching, wasting his brain. Because they know each other. He will solve an equation from answer to the question. So God knows the end. When a matter starts, he can tell you exactly how it will end and where it will end. Who will be involved when the matter will end? To the last decimal. The prophets of nowadays say things. 2016. A woman will win U.S. election, according to one prophet in Lagos. Say a woman, Hillary, will win election. When the result came out, he came back again the following Sunday and said, he didn't say woman, he said wool man. Because Nathan has his hair like this, a wool man. And everyone say, yeah! I said, oh. Mutum. What did I say? Say it loud. Mutum. It's a mystery. They were clapping. You know, initially when the election result came out, they quickly ran and removed the video. Ah! People have reshared and shared and shared. When they remove it, the video pop up again. So the man has some sense. He said, okay, I know how to deal with them. He didn't say woman, he said wool man. They were clapping. There you are. 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 So, Jesus made this statement, I am he that liveth and was dead. Jesus made this statement in his glorified deity. I am he that liveth now. Because this statement was made in Revelation 1:18. In his glorified, where was Jesus speaking in John in Revelation? From where? Answer me. Where was the location of Jesus when he was speaking in Revelation chapter 1 verse 18? Huh? In heaven. He was only speaking to John. Where was he speaking from? From heaven. This is post-resurrection. Post-ascension. He had ascended in Acts chapter 1. Ye men of Galilee, why look ye up gazing into heaven? This same Jesus, as you see him ascending, shall descend in like manner as you see him taking to heaven. Right? He has ascended already. And since he ascended, he has not returned. Has he returned? So he's in heaven. Speaking to John from heaven, I am he that is, that I am alive and was dead. Was referring to when he was on earth, full human, when he died. He that liveth and died as a man is the same that is resurrected and glorified, who is also called the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending. That one you will find in John 1 verse 18. Now, another thing they have stumbled is that no man has seen God. You find that in 1 Timothy 6 verse 16. 1 Timothy 1, 16 to 17. It says, we have to read. We have to read. 1 Timothy 6 verse 16. Who only had immortality, dwelling in the light, which no man can approach unto, whom no man has seen, nor can see. Okay? Whom no man can see, or can see. The context of this passage shows that it is Jesus Christ being referred to. It shows that whenever Jesus is in his full glory, no mortal man can see him. Look up here. When Moses said, I want to see you now, God said, no man can see me. You know why? Look up here. That time, the presence of Jesus was not visible. Was Jesus visible in Old Testament? Jesus was not visible in the Old Testament. His appearances in Old Testament was an undercover. Undercover. Not his full revelation as Christ. Because they don't even know who Christ was. in the Old Testament. Although they spoke about him, they prophesied of him, and there were people waiting to see the hope of Israel that was prophesied of. When Jesus was now brought to the temple in Luke chapter 1 and 2, Annas said, "My eye have seen the salvation of Israel, which was spoken of. Now thy servant can depart in peace." They've heard of him. It's been said about him. And they hope that one day they will see him. Only few were privileged to see him who heard of him. Okay? So, this passage is referred to Christ in his humanity. John saw and bear record. John 1:34. John saw Jesus, who is equally who? God. And bear his record. That's how you have the book of John. You have Mark. You have Luke. You have Matthew. Are you following? You have Mark. You have Matthew. You have Luke. You have John. John saw and bear record. So this talks about, it refers, it shows that whenever Jesus is in full glory, no mortal man can see him. However, when man puts on immortality, he will be able to see Christ in his full glory. Because John, 1 John 3, verse 1 to 3 says, "For we shall see him as he is." Now, let me bring revelation small to you. When the Lord took me to heaven, he appeared to me in Takum. When heaven opened, it was, I could see angel by the right. I could see angel by the left. But the personality in the middle was just an embodiment of light. You know that place we say, dwelling in where? Answer me. Dwelling in where? In light. But when he came close to me to now relate with me as a mortal man that can see him as Jesus Christ, an arm shot out from that embodiment of light, and I shook the hand. This is hand, I can see hand, but it's invisible hand, but I can see that this is a hand. I shook it, then it spoke. Now, on our journey to heaven, I was on his shoulder, full Jesus, the man of Nazareth, the Nazarene. We got to a point in the sky when I sighted the brightness of heaven, and I screamed, I shouted, "What's that I'm beholding afar?" I said, "My son, that's heaven." As we arrived at the shore gate of heaven, we entered the city of heaven. We just took some few steps, and I was walking and seeing the goal. I was asking him questions. After I finished talking with him, he told me that this is the road in heaven. Walk. This is goal. Walk. This road, walk. The one angel here, one angel, we're walking. Before I knew it, I didn't see him again. He's back to his throne. And the angel now led me to a place where I saw nobody. I only saw like mountain of white clouds and light that no man can behold. Dwelling in where? Light. That's him. From there, I heard voice, a booming voice. Booming, a voice that when he started talking, entire heaven keeps quiet. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silent. And then, after that introduction of his glorious majesty, while the angels were leading me away from there, that man of Calvary came as the Nazarene. and took me to a river in heaven. This is the river of the water of life. Now I can see the man of Calvary. Stand up, sir. I can see that he's a bit taller than myself. Like I'm taller than you now. Sit down, sir. I can see the wounds in his hands. I can see the tears on his eyes. His humanity is full God, full man. Don't be carried away. Don't be deceived. We know this truth. We have touched it. We have handled it of the word of life, and we are declaring it unto you. That which we have heard, that which we have looked upon of the word of life, declare we unto you, that you may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. Bow your head and thank that man of Calvary.
Words of